everybody, welcome to Found Flicks. The 2017 version of Stephen King's It was the most successful horror movie of last year, making nearly $700 million worldwide. Cha-ching, Richie! We've heard about a few scenes that were cut from the film, and now released on home video, we have 11 deleted scenes to check out. But apparently this isn't even all of them, including the now infamous scene where Pennywise eats a baby, which could be included on a director's cut version that is confirmed to be coming out later this year. But for now, we have a bunch of new scenes to pore over, and while many of them aren't revelatory, they do add more to what I believe is the strongest part of the movie, the characters. And I'd say for the most part that all of these scenes should have been left in the film, including the alternate ending. So let's break down the deleted scenes and alternate ending for It. Our first scene is a humorous alternate take on the initial meeting between Georgie and Pennywise at the beginning of the film. At first, everything unfolds exactly as in the movie, with during a rainstorm, Georgie losing his boat in a sewer drain and meeting Pennywise, who got a hold of Georgie's boat and lures him closer to get it back. That is until Georgie easily snatches the boat from Pennywise's mitts, offering a see you later as he runs off safe and sound, leaving Pennywise alone in the sewer with no victim, muttering shit to himself. Well, I guess the movie is over, folks. This is a pretty funny take on the iconic opening scene, and it's amusing they even bothered to film this joke version of it. Stanley didn't get quite the same character development as the other losers, and we see that some important pieces to his story were left on the cutting room floor. The first scene isn't as impactful, as it's a slight extension of Stanley interacting with his father while struggling to learn the Torah. He's chastised a bit more by his father than in the original scene, asking his son by not studying if he wants to bring shame on his family and the synagogue. Stanley is shaken by this, emotionally squeaking out "no sir" in response, and his dad tells him to take the book into his office since he's clearly not using it, where Stanley then goes on to meet it in the form of the painting in his dad's office. We actually don't get much with Bill's family in the finished movie, so I was definitely interested in seeing their dynamic. Here we see how much Georgie's death has impacted the family, starting on the house with a storm raging outside, then seeing a picture of Georgie panning over to a closed piano. Bill's mother was seen in the opening playing the piano and must have stopped after what happened to Georgie. And we see that tension continues now with the family at dinner. At first, they are all silent until Bill mentions wanting to play a trip to Arcadia, which they all went to together as a family with Georgie. Bringing this up causes immediate problems as Bill's mom slams down the dish she was cleaning and quickly leaves the room. Bill's dad apologizes, beginning to explain about how things have been different between them until Bill interrupts, offering to get some money together if that would help. But his dad says it's not about that. It was that his brother was really looking forward to that trip, saying Arcadia was his favorite and leaving. Bill, alone now at the dinner table, agrees. Mine too. I quite like this scene that shows us more of Bill's family and how Georgie's death has impacted them, which we don't really get a sense of in the movie. Another brief bit showing us more with Bill's parents, once again with his father. After encountering the Georgie puppet and Pennywise in his home's basement, Bill escapes heading upstairs and Pennywise slinks away. But now, rather than the scene ending, Bill stumbles into his dad, frantically explaining that he saw Georgie and that it's all flooded in the basement. His dad heads downstairs to check it out, and off screen we hear the distinct sound of someone sloshing in water, indicating that the basement is flooded. But Dad comes back looking unamused, saying it's dry as a bone. Bill exclaims that he did see Georgie, and his dad tells him to go to bed, brushing his story off. While not really necessary for the movie, I do like that this provides another example of how the adults in town literally can't see what Pennywise is up to. Just like the bloody bathroom at Beverly's house that her dad didn't see, the same thing is occurring here with the flooded basement, showing us once again how the adults in town choose to turn a blind eye to Derry's long troubled history. Then unrelatedly, we cut to Henry at his home in a scene that shows us a little bit more detail about what makes him such a jerk. Here he is in his room whimpering in pain, a stark contrast to his attitude seen around the kids. He retrieves some antibiotics from a shelf, applying it to fresh wounds on his back, evidence of his father beating him. We already knew that his father was abusive, but this adds a whole other layer to the pain he has been inflicting on his son. Henry then enters the main room, passing by his father, who asks him to go get another beer, and Henry silently obliges. After this, Henry's pals roll up with Henry clearly upset at his father. Here we get another mention of their friend Patrick, who was earlier taken by Pennywise. Belt says he hasn't heard anything about Patrick, but Henry says he doesn't care. They also reference the knife that was given to Henry by Pennywise, asking if Henry's dad found out about the knife he found. Henry angrily threatens that if he did find out, he would rip his dad's head off, telling Belch to drive. Where to, he asks, and they find the perfect target of where to go, seeing Mike riding by on his bike delivering meat, and they head off after him, leading to Mike being found later by the losers and the rock fight. In this brief extended scene during the losers' first visit to Nyebolt, we start with Bill, Richie, and Eddie entering the house, hearing a woman pleading upstairs to help while the others wait outside. Everyone appears scared, but Stanley is especially afraid, saying he can't go in that house, and Mike comforts him, putting a hand on his shoulder. While certainly short, this scene gives us a little bit more once again to Stanley, and just how afraid he really is of this whole thing, and still manages to pull himself together enough to do it. An even briefer scene taking place immediately in the aftermath of the first trip to Nyebolt. After encountering it and Eddie getting his arm broken, the kids escape the house running outside, and Eddie, unable to ride his bike, is put into a basket on Mike's, and they all ride off still screaming and terror over what they just witnessed. Footage of this scene is used in the finished film, but the sequence feels quite different there, with the scene set by music and with no dialogue. Here we actually get to hear Stanley's speech at his bar mitzvah, which it turns out is pretty much his biggest character moment in the film. Stanley is seen delivering the Torah at his bar mitzvah, surrounded by people and of course his father, who was already hard on him earlier. After the reading, Stanley gives a grand speech reflecting on what he just read, and how it relates to indifference. He goes on to say that when you're a kid, you think the world is safe. Then something bad happens, and suddenly that's not true. Then seeing the other losers on their own, like Mike sternly delivering a bolt into the head of a sheep at the farm, while Stanley continues in voiceover, saying if any of you opened your eyes, you'd see what we are going through. He concludes by saying indifference is part of being an adult, and that learning to be an adult in Derry means learning to not give a shit. Literally dropping the mic and leaving, with Richie standing up applauding, approving of his speech. Though his mom does not. I think this version of the scene is much more impactful and interesting than in the finished film. This feels again like Stanley's biggest character moment in the whole movie, and it was pretty much cut out. And I like seeing him being bold here and standing up for what others are unwilling to talk about. He specifically references the idea of the adults being indifferent or not being willing to listen to them about it, which is a huge part of the story. And this scene is the most direct confrontation of that idea. Another slightly extended scene, this time with Eddie being harassed by rich girl Greta at the pharmacy. In the original cut, we don't actually see her writing loser on Eddie's cast, but here we do. And the extended length, along with the cheesy elevator music playing in the background, make the scene feel a bit funnier and odder in its longer cut. At the pharmacy, Eddie goes to pick up his prescription refills, coming across Greta, earlier seen bullying Beverly, who gives Eddie grief for not having any signatures on his cast, then telling him all of his medications are placebos, to Eddie's confusion. As he's about to leave, she offers to sign his cast, and Eddie awkwardly returns, both sitting there silently while she smacks gum and signs something on his cast. Then finishes writing, pulling out her gum and sticking it on the cast, revealing she wrote loser in huge letters, which we see he later changes to lover. Even though this scene is incredibly short, clocking at a mere 26 seconds, is surprisingly important and adds a much darker layer to the movie. Right before the losers head into Nyebolt for their final battle with it, outside nearby, Henry is sitting in Belch's car watching them, his face covered in blood. Like lambs to a slaughter, right guys? He creepily says, asking his friends, then revealing both of them with their throat slit sitting dead in the car. Whoa! We already knew that Henry had lost it since he had just killed his father, but we see his actions become much more demented, openly killing his friends. It's interesting as this truly shows us how under the influence of it Henry is at this point, and the impact of seeing that he murdered his friends before he heads inside and attacks Mike would have made the whole scene much more intense. Regardless, this absolutely should have been left in, and was one moment that I was genuinely shocked upon seeing in the deleted scenes. After the losers enter Nyebolt and descend into the well, they come across tunnels scattered with the belongings of the many children it has taken over over the years. And amongst them, they find Georgie's walkie-talkie, which Bill picks up, staring at it emotionally as it starts to crackle. This small beat actually does add quite a bit, as the entirety of Bill's journey is to find out what happened to his brother. That's why there is also the chance that Pennywise left the walkie specifically for them to find, luring them deeper into the sewer for answers about Georgie. I also like it as it somewhat addresses the many objects that litter its lair from his many victims. All of these belong to different kids taken by Pennywise, and Georgie is only one out of the many. The theatrical ending of the movie does feel a bit abrupt, ending with Bill kissing Beverly and the two saying goodbye. But originally there was an additional scene after this with Bill's family loading up the car, heading out on a family vacation. Dad goes inside and Mom opens up to Bill, having a moment of catharsis after their tension scene earlier. She tells Bill that wherever they're going, she knows it's not Arcadia, and already getting emotional, says maybe we can make some new memories, just us. This pays off on the earlier deleted scene with Bill wanting to try to bring the family together by going to Arcadia, his brother's favorite spot they all must have gone to many times. And here we see his mom is finally starting to move on after losing Georgie and trying to rebuild some kind of happiness. And for Bill, this hope of moving on is important too, as he desperately hoped to find his brother, only to lose him to it. Bill is silent after talking with his mom, but we can see he is still affected by losing Georgie, and stares down at his hand, looking at the fresh cut from the blood pact with the other losers, vowing to reunite if it ever returns again. Then the family wagon drives away through the neighborhood, and as they pass by, we linger on a storm drain, accompanied by an ominous growling tone, and a few drops of rain begin to fall, alluding that the battle with Pennywise is far from over. I have to say this version of the ending feels a lot more complete and emotionally conclusive for the reasons we've seen. As we see here, Bill will eventually be able to move on and have a normal life after encountering it, even though he inevitably will be drawn back in as an adult. Should have left this one in there, Andy. That'll wrap it up for my breakdown of the deleted scenes we've gotten so far for the new It. Like I said, they don't necessarily change the whole film, but everything cut was still strong material that added more to the movie. In particular, the scenes with Bill's family, Stanley's bar mitzvah speech, and Henry having killed his pals. Though I can understand why they were cut, since the movie already runs over 2 hours in the theatrical version. Hopefully the next release will include that Pennywise baby eaten flashback scene, so we can finally see how disturbing it really is. Or maybe an extended dance scene. What did you guys think of the It deleted scenes? Which ones are the most interesting to you? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Make sure to like, subscribe, and follow. Thanks for watching Found Flicks. See you next time.